Okay, so what I thought I would do today is give a little bit more of a research type presentation and just show you a little bit of some of the applications, what we're working on. But like every other time, feel free to ask lots of questions. And if we don't get to the end, no big deal. But this is much shorter in terms of length of slides, so I've adjusted to the last 2 days, so I think it'll be good. Okay. So here we have just a depiction of the phylogenetic tree of life. And so one of the things that we're very interested in is trying to map out metabolism as well as possible across all of these different clades. And one of the things that we would like to be able to do and are seeking kind of a large scale project in the U.S. on this is to be able to come in and look at a particular clade, work it out, do a representative careful reconstruction of one of those, and then expand it so that we can start to understand more about metabolism as it is existing across a broad swath of life. So one of the areas where we started with and have done a lot of work recently is in methanogen. So I'm going to talk just a little bit about that to start with. So methane production is a critical component of the global carbon cycle. So depending on how you count this, for every mole of methane that's made you in methanogenesis, you also make a mole of CO2. And if you count those up, 8% of the global carbon cycle circulates through methane. And so most of this comes from methanogens, which can, right, so you got 4% here from termites, 20% from ruminants. You have methanogens in lakes and oceans and landfills. In rice paddies, in wetlands, and so forth. But basically, in many, many different conditions, these organisms exist that essentially output most of the methane that we have in the world. So we've built a number of tools for helping to push forward semi-automated metabolic reconstructions of related species. And so just so you're aware of them in case they're useful to you, we've built something called the Integrated Toolkit for the Exploration of Pan-Genomes, or ITEP, which essentially is a comparative genomics package that enables us to build out comparisons across clades of related species. We've built also recently a media database. This is just a collection of growth media for lots of different types of organisms. It was interesting because we have not been able to find, in the public domain at least, a big database like this. Eitan Rupin's group recently published one as well, and so this is starting to be built out there. Why this is useful is especially when we try to go about doing automated reconstructions, or we try to learn how to read from a genome just what its optimal culture conditions would be. You'd like to have a database or a set of media against which to compare to, so you can do machine learning and things like that. So we built out a resource for that. And then we've also built something called likelihood-based network gap filling. And I'm going to talk about these a little bit as we go forward. Okay, so for methanogens, we've done three sort of keystone metabolic reconstructions following the process that I talked about in the last couple of days. So for one of these, this is around an organism called Methanosarcina sedivorans, Methanosarcina barkeri, and Methanococcus maripilutus. And this, you can see the references there. As we try to do in every one of these cases, and I should have emphasized this probably a little bit more over the last couple days, is whenever we do one of these reconstructions as a research problem, we always like to team with someone who is a world expert in the biology of that organism. Right, so we come in and do many organisms. But for the Methanosarcina, we worked with Bill Metcalf, who's one of the world's foremost experts in those organisms. And for Methanococcus, we are currently working with John Lay, who again is one of the foremost experts in the world on those organisms. That becomes really important in terms of the kinds of partnership that one would have between computational biologists and experimental biologists. And so that has been really valuable for us. Okay. So I'm going to just talk you through a few of the cases that I had mentioned. So this is something called ITEP, right, which is this toolkit for comparative genomics and curation. So here we start with a data source. It could come from something called KBase or NCBI. KBase, which you may or may not be familiar with, this is a program that's been driven by, in the United States, by the Department of Energy, but aims to be a central repository for biological models and to provide tools for biological modeling. NCBI is a similar effort for the related to work at the National Institutes of Health and so forth. And essentially what we get also then is to take these together in a second step and just run scripts and build out a database. So this allows us to take, basically for any organism, get gene location sequencing, we do blasting, clustering, context sequences, and so forth. So you just build out sort of what's in each of those genomes in an annotation pipeline. And then step three, ITEP interfaces to these databases to help analyze and interpret genomes. So we can do for certain clades analysis of gene gain and loss patterns. You can look at gene context for different phylogenies. And I'm going to talk more about some of the results from this in a moment. And then you can, for the reconstructions, it then allows us to look at a reconstruction in one organism. And as we map it to a related organism, observe what are the changes in the metabolism between those organisms. That can be useful either for looking at the evolution of these networks or for trying to build out more accurate models of related species to the ones that you've spent a year or two building in some detail. Okay. So we did a project with the Metcalf lab. And so here we were looking at species that fall into the methanosarcinales. And so what you see here in red are sequences that that we did with the Metcalf lab in this project. And in blue are those that were pre-existing. Okay, so we end up with a pretty reasonable swath of methanogens to analyze. So if you look at that, you run them through the algorithms that I was just mentioning, we end up with a map here where we can show all the elements of metabolism that are conserved across that entire clade. Okay, so this is your core metabolic map for everything that is in common amongst all of the sequenced methanogens. So of course, along with that then, we can also pull up all of the variable metabolism, those aspects that have been altered over the course of the evolution of that, that clade, or that are different amongst them. Okay. So if you look then at these independent genes that are involved in these organisms, then you can see some interesting patterns, right? And these have been observed by others, of course. But what you get are complexes which either always appear together, as you can see here. So in gray shows that these this particular gene complexes are in a particular species. White means they're not. And so you can see that in every single case these appear together, and in no cases do they appear separately. Okay? So that tells you that there's some sort of a linkage either in their evolution or their function or something like that. If I shift over one column, you can see the opposite case, where essentially, other than in just a couple species, these two particular components never appear together. And so as you start going through, you can look at and see a number of interesting patterns of co-occurrence or non-co-occurrence and so forth. So you can then use this kind of an approach to compare across all the curated methanosarcina. And so here you can see green here is the gene is present, red is absent. And so you end up having a core set of reactions, right, that is available in every case. Then you start to have others for which they're missing. Now, one of the things that is really interesting as you go through this is that you can use this kind of data as an evaluation of the quality of your genome annotation. And you can actually use this kind of an approach to fix a number of aspects of your model. So one of the things that comes up is that when we look at loss patterns for certain genes, let me back up just a second. We also, because of, we can look in the models that we have generated in the methanogens, we can evaluate reactions that are essential, okay? So what we do then is that we can go through the clades, and when we lose a reaction that is essential, what turns out is that you see two very distinct patterns. In one pattern, when we see loss, it happens in a particular clade, right? So we can look at the presumed relationships in evolution, and you can see, okay, this function was lost. And that tells you, all right, we need to figure out how these cells are able to have had a different function so that they can make up for something that's essential. Conversely, in many of these cases, you have randomly distributed patterns. And what we found is that in those cases, it's very often an error in the annotation. And in a few of those cases, actually, Bill Metcalf's group has gone back and validated that, in fact, the genes, that there are genes that carry out that essential function. So we end up with a misannotation. So I think that's interesting because it provides a method by which we can go back and forth between network reconstruction, sequence comparisons in evolution, and do error correction across both. Yeah. Yeah, Priyanka.
Of Methanococcus, is it advisable to use the same biomass objective function for all these strains or have them separately?
Yeah, that's a great question. So the biomass functions can differ quite, pretty reasonably across the methanogens. And even though these are methanogens, they're all archaea, but their range of evolution is pretty massive, actually. And so, much, much broader across the methanogens than, say, certainly than all mammals or things like that. And so, so there is a lot of variation. That said, in many experimental cases, you don't really have a much better biomass function. And so you try to coarse grain it a lot by just the amount of protein versus lipids or carbohydrates, yeah, and so forth. So ITEP then, you can look for these patterns in gene gain and loss, as is shown here, either where the genes are becoming more prevalent or where you're losing them, and so forth. Okay. Anyway, that's just to give a little bit of a sense for how we integrate the network reconstruction process with comparative genomics. And we have, just so you're aware, in case any of these are of interest and you want to talk about them later, we have built reconstructions in my lab for a variety of different organisms. The Methanosarcina methanococcus I just mentioned. We've also built one for Clostridium bioerinchii, which is a butanol producer. We've done one for Neurospora crassa, which is for protein production, plant cell wall degradation. This will be submitted for publication hopefully shortly. And we also have done yeast 6, which is a platform organism. Okay. So because we want to map this out as much as possible across across the variety of different aspects of life, and there are, of course, a lot of big efforts now in microbiome, both in the human as well as across the Earth, we obviously need approaches that are scalable, right, that won't take a year per organism to try to manually reconstruct. And even a year per organism is, of course, much underselling that because you've got to do all the experiments as well. And so we wanted scalable approaches that will help us to get network reconstructions as fast as possible from high throughput data, and particularly from genomics. And there's been some progress in this field over the past several years. In this 2010 Nature Biotechnology paper, this was kind of the first big automated approach called the model seed, which has been in development and continues getting better year by year, but essentially allows one to input a genome and output at the end a model. These models are much better, much more optimized if you can put in different kinds of validation data, such as biolog phenotyping data, so essentially growth assays on various different substrates and so forth, gene knockouts and so forth, as we talked about. And so this, though, is a process by which you can go about building a draft metabolic model from a genome, and this has been done now in thousands of different organisms. So it's a starting point. The accuracy from genomics in terms of its either biolog or gene essentiality is 65%. And so better than random, but a long way to go. With biolog data and optimization, then these come out in the automated pipeline at about 87%. And this has been getting better. This is why there's still a lot of room for manual reconstruction, but we have to get to the point to where we can go to these models very quickly if we're going to scale up across all the different clades of life that we want to understand from this perspective. Okay, so we jumped into this as well recently. And this is a paper we published in PLOS Computational Biology last year, trying to see if we could also aid in improving automated metabolic model building. So again, you start from an annotated genome. You utilize reaction databases that are out there, KEG or the big database from the Paulson lab, come up with a preliminary reconstruction. And then in general, as I mentioned on the first day, you end up with some unknowns. This preliminary reconstruction never works very well. You end up with some unknowns, right, which are usually less than 10% of the genes and more than 90% of the effort to figure out when you're doing this. The gold standard is hand-curated literature and then iterative testing with experiments, right? But this is a labor-intensive process, as I discussed. And so the gold standard way that this is done, is not terribly automated yet. So what we want to do instead here is to do what's called gap filling or automated gap filling algorithms to try to fill in the difference between this preliminary reconstruction and an optimized model and automate this tougher part as much as possible. So there's been a number of developments in how to do this, and I'll talk about those in a minute. The typical one that's been used so far is something called gap filling, which typically closes gaps based on parsimony. So what I mean by that is if we have, here's just a simple cartoon network diagram, right? There are a couple potential pathways shown here. So the formation of A or B being consumed here, we have known genes, known reactions, but there's some unknown steps in between, and we have to figure out what those are. So the prior approach, so what most has done is that you have some database where you just list all the known biochemistry, right? And that's what these either grayed out or in green are shown here. And then you try to find the most parsimonious way, so the fewest number of reactions you have to assume in order to make this connection. And that's what's known typically as gap filling. Okay. And so here we would pick these two reactions that would create a link rather than these three reactions up top. So what we've done is a little bit of a different path, which is to use what we call a likelihood-based approach to gap filling. So rather than just map biochemistry and pick the shortest path, what we're doing is essentially looking for evidence in the genome for orthologs to genes that catalyze these different reactions, and assigning a probability of existence to every single reaction based on the evidence that we see in the genome. And so, in essence, how this works is that we create a graph in which the length of any particular edge is related to a score that's inversely proportional to the probability of that being there. So in other words, if you had 100% probability of something being there or very close to that, then the distance of that reaction would or that link in the network would be assumed to be near zero. If you had very little, then you would incur a larger penalty. And these probabilities, I should say, are really it's really a relative probability because we have no way to to establish exactly what the probability of existence is, but we use essentially just E-values from blast scores and things like that. And so in essence then what we would see is that in organism one, we might choose this shortest path because there's evidence for it, but in organism two, we might have fairly modest evidence for one of these paths, but that would come out to be better than taking a path that has no evidence. And so this is what we call probabilistic gap filling, and this is a way for us to try and fill in the gaps as best as possible with a probabilistic annotation. So the way that we do that, and I should pull this, I don't have this here exactly. So what we do is we construct a large graph, okay? And so you construct this graph, and then we assign a score that is based on the E-value of a blast, essentially, search for an ortholog enzyme. Let's see, maybe I can pull this up here. Let me see if I've got the exact thing here. Okay, so here's more of the details in terms of how it operates. So essentially there is a score, so we just do a blast of the E value, and then you have this score cap basically just so that we always have something for it to compare to, and then you have a score threshold. So it's a score that is related primarily then to the strength of the blast hit, basically. How good is the ortholog? And then in the annotation, so you get a likelihood of the annotation A for gene I. And again, you're just doing a summation then over all of these scores divided by, a normalization factor. And then you sum those all up. And then you get what's called a pseudo count. And so basically, we came up with a score that enables us to evaluate the likelihood that for a particular annotation. And so, and this is all in the paper, so if you want to go through all the details, it's all in the paper. But in essence, so we get a protein sequence, we look at the blast against these seed subsystems, we convert them to these log scores, calculate this annotation score, convert that to a reaction, and then if the probability is above some threshold, then it gets included. And then we do, and let's see, where is this? Right, and so then you get a score that's a relative score. So if it's high, then we say, okay, this is really likely to be there. Anything that's super high is probably already there from our beginning methods. And if it's kind of in the middling, you'll get something that's kind of a middle kind of score. And sometimes you have conflicting evidence, so you might go with different kinds of annotations. And then what's done is that on the top of those pathways, so one of the really important things is that for a particular sequence, you can have maps to multiple possible orthologs, especially if you're kind of down in the middling range. So maybe you have kind of a 40% probability that it's one reaction and a 35% that it's another and so forth. One of the things that is helpful about this method is that when you have to fill in those gaps, you can use some of those secondary annotations because they will fit in with the topology of what you know is needed. And so because you're looking for that, you're really just making your best guess about how to do the fill-in. And so in that sense, you're picking up some of the information from these less likely annotations, but still much better than anything else that you have to explain. So when you know that the function must exist, it then leads you to pick some of these lower, some of these things that are maybe possible ortholog matches but fall below threshold. And it also means that in some of these cases, you could predict more something that might even say that the enzyme is promiscuous in terms of the different reactions that it has to carry out, because it might, you know, because of the way that different pathways are filled in, you might say that it carries out, you know, both of those functions as being the best possible explanation for functions that have to occur. Does that make a little more sense? I know I didn't go through that all in tremendous detail.
Because for the
you would have to have a GPR. That's right. If you don't have, well, that's what you're trying to get here, right? Is your GPR, because you have a reaction. You say these are known reactions in some other organism. You know that this gene catalyzes that reaction. You're then mapping by ortholog into your current gene, and you may have multiple mappings. Some cases, because if it has a really high reverse best hit blast, and it's really a good match, then it should already be in our reconstruction because we've already done all those. But what you're trying to pick up here is from that residual information, rather than pick a parsimonious solution, which may have absolutely no evidence, you would pick whatever is the path to fill in gaps for which you've got at least some evidence or some marginal amount of evidence. And then you just keep that score in your reconstruction so that when you go back to it, and then you're making a putative gene-protein reaction association, a new one. And in fact, you're actually making a new annotation in the genome. You're saying that this gene that may have, you know, unknown function because it didn't cross like the threshold that you'd like just at, you know, as your gold standard at baseline, but you're now saying this is the best guess for what, you know, the best estimate for what can fill in these known physiologic needs. Does that make sense? Okay, so using that kind of approach, then this is one actual example that comes from Bacillus subtilis. So previous reconstructions had used this pathway going through mevalonic acid and so forth down to lipid synthesis, because this was the smallest way to get from the starting point to the end point. Whereas what we would claim was actually the right path, because we could find evidence in the genome that made these not necessary, is that you go from, in this case, a longer path, but pyruvate, glyceride 3-phosphate, down through the various steps that you see here, feeding back into isopentyl diphosphate. So this was a case where we were able to say in our reconstruction that we could enable growth of the cell and all the things that it was supposed to do with a longer pathway, but for which we actually had evidence in the genome all along the way. And so this is just a way to try to optimize pulling out some of those lower confidence associations. Okay, so let's see how this worked. So when we applied this across a bunch of different organisms, which is shown here, then this was between 5% and 30% of the reactions from the likelihood-based gap fill were not found in the network-based solutions, okay? So you get certainly a number of things that don't come up by just doing parsimony, right? There's definitely overlap, but you do get a range of additional reactions that you pull out this way. And again, it's not a huge number of reactions. Like if we look here, the overall increase in the number of reactions is about 7%. So it's like I was telling you in that gap, you get most of it by just, you know, pulling out the high confidence stuff. This is to try to help automate that last bit that's hard of figuring out how do you fill in everything, all the little pieces, so that you can get this thing to grow reasonably well. And so as you can see here then, again, across a large number of different organisms, red are those that are unique to our likelihood-based approach. And the green show the number of reactions that were added uniquely by the parsimony-based approach. And so you see that we get quite a few more unique reactions in the likelihood based approach, as you might expect. Okay. All right, so we also wanted to see how much this had an effect on predicting phenotype data. And this is kind of interesting because we actually don't see a huge effect in terms of the overall accuracy. And probably this is in part due to the fact that these are relatively small numbers that are added. But if we look at the sensitivity and specificity of the overall model being able to predict biolog data, you can see that we're very similar for the network-based versus the likelihood-based. And for the essentiality data in terms of knockouts, you can see sensitivity, specificity, almost exactly the same. So one of the interesting things here, at least for our field, is that fitting to phenotypes doesn't necessarily tell you which gap fill solution is correct. So ours have a lot more evidence for at the genome level, but you don't see much, you know, we don't see any differentiation, at least in the early tests we've done, for just these phenotype predictions. And it gets to another larger point for the metabolic modeling field, which is that there's a pretty big need for more powerful ways to validate these kind of models. The gene essentiality and the yields and so forth are nice, but there's a lot that can't be resolved in that way. And so we really need much more kinds of evidence to be included in these models. Okay, and I mentioned that all of this is being integrated with the DOE knowledge base. And so this just allows us to make these tools accessible. So this likelihood-based gap fill is also integrated with this knowledge base. Okay, so take-home points from the first part of the talk. So metabolic models, as we've already discussed, have been built for many organisms. They can provide a powerful means for integrating omics data, and we can leverage them with evolutionary relationships, as I showed today, which helps us better annotate genomes and build better models of related species. And then we can do probabilistic annotation by a likelihood, and it provides a path for, we hope, better automated reconstructions that are rooted in more genomic evidence. Okay. All right, so we'll move to the next section. So here, I'm going to pick up where we left off yesterday, talking about this PROM model. And we have a new approach that we call iDREAM for integrated deduced regulation and metabolism, which is currently under review. And what we're doing here is linking PROM with another algorithm, which is called EGRIN, which was developed in Nitin Baliga's group at the Institute for Systems Biology. And so what Nitin's group has done is they've built this approach called Environment and Gene Regulatory Inference Network. And so here, and this is an approach to identify condition-specific regulators. And they've published a couple of different papers on this. The initial paper in 2007 in Cell. And so essentially what this does is it identifies relationships, or it can learn relationships from transcription factors to sets of regulated genes. And so in order to put these together, what we do is we take this EGRIN model. And I should say the big advantage here is that with EGRIN integrated, we can look at both interactions for which we have known like transcription factor binding information, which is what we leverage typically in PROM. But here we can also learn from gene expression, from sequence motifs, from a number of different kinds of data. And so it means that this is why we call this deduced regulation, in the sense that you can also get into some previously unknown aspects of regulation. So here, for the EGRINs, what we do is EGRIN returns a false discovery rate around each of these different interactions, and we feed this into PROM in place of the probabilities that we learn from gene expression on top of the transcription factor binding information. And so in essence then, this probability becomes related to the false discovery rate for a particular transcription factor having an influence around a gene. And then we propagate that down to the enzyme and have it affect metabolism in just the way we talked about yesterday with PROM. And so you have three different kinds of interactions then. You have an egrin influence, which is something that is just learned de novo. There is an egrin direct, which means that this is the subset of what we learned from egrin that also has the transcription factor binding information. And it turns out that these are by far our most informative edges. And then we also have egrin direct inhibitions. So when we compared this with the original PROM, we ended up getting quite a bit better results. And you'll see here that, I'll just walk you through it. So in terms of correlation, we don't get super high correlations. And a lot of that is due to a lot of the facts that you heard from Gary's talk this morning, which is that there's tons of regulation that occurs in these systems that isn't transcriptional. But this is about where we're at. So in terms of being able to predict the growth rate of transcription factor knockouts in yeast, we get, with the original PROM model, we just get between 0.1 and 0.2 correlation. The 0.2 here is significant, but only barely so. Here's your sum of squared error, and the normalized sum of squared error with the p-value you can see here, right? So 0.029. So significant, but again, not super significant. That's using all 90 transcription factors. This is using just a subset of 51 transcription factors just for comparison. So in the iDream model, which is an integration of egrin and PROM in a hybrid, and there's a couple different ways that we did this, but in both iterations, we get better than 0.4 correlation, as high as 0.43. P-value, 0.002, 0.014, so much more significant. Lower sum of squared errors, and when we do this normalized sum of squared error, then we again get low p-values, 0.003, 0.004. So what this meant was that for yeast, we were able to get some reasonable signal by integrating it with the egrin in this new iDream approach. Oh, and I should mention, because I didn't say this, we had been trying to do a reasonable PROM model for yeast for a while and really have not had good accuracies with it. So PROM, we've gotten much better accuracies in E. coli and in various bacteria, but as we've gone into eukaryotic systems that are more complicated, that really hasn't held up very well. So this new iDream approach is really the first approach that's been able to get some reasonable signal for this kind of model in a eukaryote. Yeah, Ben. Yeah, so what it is, and I should have, yeah, a plot of that. Sorry about that. I should have had a plot of that. I'm missing that slide. So in essence, all this is plotting the, I apologize, I don't have this. I should have this in here. Basically, it's just it's the growth rate of a transcription factor knockout. That is predicted versus the growth rate of a transcription factor knockout that's measured experimentally. I don't know, does that look like a 0.4 or something? So it's basically that. So it's the correlation between the prediction of the growth rate for a transcription factor knockout versus versus what it was measured experimentally. So it's basically just a cloud of points. What I just wanted to emphasize was that we've never really been able to get the straight up PROM model that uses just the Yeastrack database to give us a really highly correlated prediction. Well, in some ways this might relate to our conversation right before, Sanjay. this correlation here really not good for just the gene expression. But when we integrated it with with Egrin and forming this new iDream approach, that got us far from perfect, but significant. And the first time after several years of trying where we had something that got some signal, reasonable signal in a eukaryote for this integrated approach. And if you look at it, so here's some more of this data. So this is just the Matthews correlation coefficient. And so Matthews correlation coefficient is used to discriminate how well you're predicting in various cases. And then we just looked at, Matthews correlation coefficient is used in making binary predictions. And so the ones we were most interested in are if we took as lethal or highly compromised something that had less than 10% of its initial growth rate, or 20 or 30 or 40 or 50 or so forth, then basically what we saw was that the Egrin or the iDream model significantly outperform just the base prom for yeast, and that's what's shown here. We did also permutation tests by 500 randomly assigned regulatory associations and expression data sets at the same time, and all those associations were found to be significant. Okay, so here, this just shows that this Matthews correlation coefficient, again, between the predicted and experimental growth changes in the different media. So I just showed how it came out for glucose. Galactose, again, the iDream outperformed. Glucose with urea medium, not quite as good, but again, outperformed here. And the three media combined, what you see is a much greater performance. And it's really the difference between these at the lower cutoffs that we're most interested in. Up here, it's kind of noisy, and you don't get any sort of real separation. Any questions about that? Does that make sense? These are not commonly used plots. So if we compare then this Matthews correlation coefficient, our ability to do predictions by setting different thresholds, this is just a summary of that. And so what you can see is that we applied this across a bunch of different yeast models just to see if it was independent of the different yeast models. And so we got, as we do in almost every case, yeast 6, which is the reconstruction that Ben Hevner in my lab led. That's the most accurate of the models that we found. IMM904 was the next, but in every case still. And then this is just the ratio. So if we pick the ones that are most interesting, if we pick half of growth as being our binary cutoff, less than half of growth is here, or if we took our binary cutoff as less than 0.2 of the growth rate, again, you start getting a quite nice signal out of those. Okay. And then what we could also do is evaluate the double deletion of a transcription factor and a metabolic gene. Okay, and these are all the predictions that come out of that. And what we found was predictions for nine different genes that we predicted would be highly synthetic lethal to the transcription factor and the deletion of a metabolic gene. And what we were able to show was that that validated in 3 out of the 9 cases. And if we took genes that were controls for which that prediction wasn't made, then they were synthetically lethal 0% of the time. So this is, you can see, so we get, you know, a third of these correct in a sense, but that's a bit a significant enrichment beyond kind of the background, which is that most typically transcription factor and metabolic combinations are non-lethal, overwhelmingly so. So this is pretty reasonable hit to find 3 out of the 9, actually. And this is experimental data for that, just showing that with serial dilution, with the double knockout, that you get more killing in each of these cases. Okay. All right, take home points number 2. So PROM, introduced yesterday, is an approach for integrating transcription with metabolism. And so basically, What we've been able to do then is to expand it now into this new iDream approach, integrating it with eGRIN. And we're excited about this. It's early stage and it's, you know, it's early kind of signals, but this does represent the first time we've been able to get statistically significant predictive power of this kind of integrated gene regulatory and metabolic network for a eukaryote. So we're excited about that. Okay. Yeah. Yeah, okay. So we predicted 9 that would be synthetic lethal, and then 3 of those experimentally validated, and the other 6 didn't. Transcription factor knockouts in general are very rarely lethal. They're lethal less than 10% of the time. So there aren't that many that really will cause the cell to die. It's very uncommon, actually.
Just the known transcription factor target gene interaction or the newly inferred interactions also, like using some correlation measures to...
Yeah, so eGRIN itself can learn new associations. What we found worked the best in the eukaryotic system was actually to focus our predictions around basically the intersection, to take a smaller number of interactors as being relevant that were both predicted by eGRIN and that we had evidence for from direct evidence. That's what performed absolutely the best for us. But the incorporation of eGRIN means that you get the whole thing, but the really strong predictions come out of that overlap.
On what basis they infer the new interactions, like new transcription factor target?
So new interactions are based, there's a statistical score that you go through, and it's based on one, co-expression patterns,
correlation
basically in a modified linear model. It has a couple non-linear elements to it. And then you have, so you've got the regression. You have another part of the statistical score that is based on looking for upstream motifs. So you have transcription factor, it has a binding motif, and so you get a bump in the score. So basically it's looking for things where it looks like it's got a motif for that transcription factor binding upstream of the gene, and you have a linear correlation. And it's not quite linear because they have this either an and or a nor, or there's a logical operation that can allow it to be have a small non-linear component to it. But basically then you do a regression and you learn that, you know, a model based on the expression of some set of transcription factors will predict a particular gene or a particular cluster. And they also, they tie this, Nitin Baliga's group ties this a lot with something called biclustering. So they cluster sets of genes that are highly correlated within a particular set of conditions, and then they often will operate on predicting for those biclusters. And we get you the papers, you can look at it, and all the detail needed to go through all the math. Yeah. Okay. All right, so now I'm gonna tell you about another story here. And this is constraining regulatory network states using a metabolic network. So far, what we've been doing is taking a regulatory network, combining it with a metabolic network into a unified model and making predictions. I'm going to do something very different here, actually. So what this is, and this is the only effort like this that I know about, is I'm going to try to use the fact, the connection between a gene regulatory and a metabolic network to improve the prediction of the gene regulatory network itself, okay? And I just want to show that. So basically, the question, or what I was really interested in here is when you're inferring a gene regulatory network, right, they're just variables, right? So I'm looking at correlation patterns like we just talked about. I'm doing a prediction based on some network inference. I'm looking at motifs, whatever. But those genes don't get formed in a vacuum. In other words, we know, at least especially for metabolic genes, how they're all connected at the end. So we know that, you know, the targets of some of these genes are going to form glycolysis or the TCA cycle or different, you know, whatever. And so the question is that useful to us in any sense? Is it useful to us to know how all the biochemistry of the gene products are related when we're trying to understand a gene regulatory network or trying to come up with it? So network inference, right, which is the problem of trying to take high throughput data and reconstruct a network, is notoriously challenging, right? It's called, this is referred commonly as an inverse problem. And it's notoriously challenging. And in general, of course, it's not possible to solve completely, right? You can just prove that this isn't possible based on the amount of data that we have. And the reasons for this is that extremely many networks are possible, right? The combinatorics of all the possible gene regulatory networks that could exist to explain the amount of the data that we have is astronomical, right? Huge. And so overlap, so when these networks are reconstructed, overlap with mechanism is often minimal, at least when they're done de novo. This is why in PROM and other things, we leverage heavily transcription factor binding information because we don't want to consider all versus all comparisons because this... Is there what? I'm sorry. Any example of... I'm sorry, I don't understand.
I want to just asking any example related to overlapping mechanism with...
Is there any example? Sure, I mean, anytime... basically I'm just saying when you infer a gene regulatory network, I mean, often you'll get a 50% overlap with mechanism or something like that. I mean, I guess I don't understand what you mean by a specific example. I mean, an example of this would be if you're learning from gene expression and it tells you that transcription factor A regulates enzyme B, and then you do chip-chip information, right? And then a positive, an overlap would mean that when you look at the binding for that transcription factor A, that it in fact does bind to enzyme B. And if you delete transcription factor A or you overexpress it, it has the corresponding effect on enzyme B that you think it should, right? So, I mean, all that means is that the experimental evidence for mechanism overlaps with what you inferred. Does that make sense? Okay. But this overlap with mechanism can often be small. So measurements like chip, 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 sync, as I was just mentioning, they also have many binding events that aren't functional. So there's a lot of noise in sort of how this problem goes about, right? And what you're doing in the inference problem, of course, is just taking your components and trying to infer what are the relationships between them. Okay, so why try to link regulatory networks with metabolism? So one is we can link expression changes with larger phenotypes via metabolism. And this is really interesting because if you just have your gene regulatory network, it's not obvious to say that deleting a transcription factor or overexpressing a transcription factor will have an effect on growth rate, right? And it's not even that easy to say if it would be lethal or not. Right? As long as you're only dealing with a transcriptional regulatory network, those kinds of connections are difficult. So by linking a gene regulatory network with a metabolic network, you now have a whole bunch of data that you can use in the comparison that was totally useless to you before. A second reason for doing this is that it provides a biochemically detailed framework on which to integrate regulatory influences. Okay, so it's you know the context for what the endpoint is. And then the other way that this came out was that I actually had a master's student who was working on the earlier days of PROM, and we wanted to see if we could get away with not having any chip-seq or any chip data, and if we could just use an inference method, and we tried a couple back then, Arachne and CLR. And what was so interesting is that when we used those inferred networks, PROM totally failed. And when we did it on top of known binding information, it did quite well. And so that was disappointing to us initially, because what we'd really wanted to show was that you could do just fine just doing a bunch of gene expression data. But if you flip that around, what was interesting was that it meant the problem model could tell the difference when we fed it a network that was mechanistic compared to a network that was just statistically inferred. And then we thought, well, maybe that's useful. Maybe that, you know, that, you know, turn a failure into a positive, right? Maybe that's interesting. So the project goal then is that we want to infer from high throughput data regulatory network state that is compatible with measured growth phenotypes, gene expression data, and the metabolic network. Okay, so we're going to feed in some new information. Okay, so we're going to use YeastRACT here. And so YeastRACT has different buckets of information. So one is that it has connections that it for which it's annotated as having direct evidence. This means that you have CHIP or other analyses that strongly suggest the transcription factor interacts with that specific target promoter. So we would say this would fall into like overlap with mechanism. Right? We'd say this is something that is thought to be mechanistic. You have another set that has indirect evidence. And indirect evidence means that there is an analysis of gene expression changes in response to a deletion. Right? So you delete the transcription factor, it has this effect. Could be indirect, could be direct, so it's annotated as indirect, and so for mutation or overexpression of a given transcription factor. And then you have a set in there that are putative, for which you don't have any of this kind of evidence, but it's just a prediction from a motif-finding algorithm. Okay? So direct evidence is the best, then indirect, then putative. All right. And so we developed an approach. And this was all done with a fantastic student of mine, Srirama Chandrasekaran, who's currently at Harvard, now on the faculty search at the moment. He was supposed to get married in Chennai last weekend. I was supposed to be there, but as we know, that was tough with all the flooding. Anyway, so we did Gemini. And so this is the first method that refines a transcriptional regulatory network by linking it to metabolism. Let's see. So in essence, what we're doing then, and so this is just a first step. So I'll show kind of what this first step does. So for every transcription factor, it has a bunch of links to different genes. Okay, and those can be, and those links in YeastRACT can either be those direct interactions, the indirect interactions, or putative. And we want to get an analysis for how this works. So as we come in, then the model predicts what the effect is via PROM, and Sriram also was the developer of PROM. So what we do is we take the putative interaction. For every putative interaction, we say, if we knocked out this transcription factor, and it had this effect, what would we predict would be the effect on the downstream growth rate? And then we just ask the question, is it agree with experiment? Does it not agree with experiment, right? So we're just trying to test how much signal there might be here, okay? So we just are now evaluating a prediction via PROM in terms of how it will have an effect on this growth rate. Okay, so in doing that then, all we're going to do at this first step is to just separate into buckets what we make a correct prediction about and what we make an incorrect prediction about. And what we want to know is, do we get an enrichment for known mechanistic interactions in the true prediction category compared with the false prediction category? So we have a total of 31,000 interactions. And then when we map it onto metabolism, our refined network, we have 22,000 where it is in agreement. The putative category, we go from 22,805 to 14,920 that are in the refined network. The refined network means that we kept the interaction because it was its knockout predictions were in agreement when we mediated it through the metabolic network. Indirect went from 3625 down to 3094, and direct in the refined went from 4645 to 4043. So the question is, did we keep more of the direct and indirect that had evidence than proportionally than we did things for which there was not evidence? And that's shown here. So in essence, what happens then as we look at these counts is that Gemini, if you look at the, so if these splits are happening at random, we just did a p-value just using Fisher's exact test for how significant was the enrichment for real mechanistic interactions by filtering it through metabolism in this way. And what I found to be remarkable was that, so if we look at random, so at random we should have had an overlap of 2900 here, right, p-value of 1. With Gemini, we had a p-value of 10 to the -159 in terms of the enrichment for mechanistic associations by just evaluating whether or not we believed something to be, to have evidence or not, just based on what its effect would be predicted to be via the metabolic network, okay, in Gemini. Now we compared that to the signal that we would get if we used either mutual information or correlation. So if we instead had our list ranked by the top hits for having mutual information, the highest mutual information shared between the transcription factor and the putative target across all of the hundreds of gene expression data, or using correlation in the same way. And this is the amount of enrichment we got from mutual information and correlation. So p-value of 0.005 or 10 to the minus 8th, significant, right? Not very significant. Massively more signal from integrating with metabolism. The reason I think this is significant and why I think it's really interesting, even though it's an early stage, is that there are literally hundreds of papers trying to amplify this signal. And this is the first paper that's trying to amplify this signal, which I think is a lot bigger. And so so with all the methods making the same number of predictions. Now, if you're following this, then you might ask yourself a question, which is, or you might raise a concern or a doubt, which is what I did, which is that we are going down, this is just making exactly the same number of predictions based on mutual information of correlation as we did from Gemini, which means that it's quite a long list. Okay, and so because of that, wow, and I really need to update this slide. This was published in 2014. I have all kinds of versions of this that are right. I've dropped in the old one, obviously. Anyway, this is, let's see. All right, so one of the things that you might have a question about is, all right, sure, as you go down really far in the list, maybe mutual information and correlation aren't that informative, but maybe they're really informative about the top few. Okay, so what we did, in fact, was we're going to allow mutual information and correlation, we're essentially going to allow them to overfit to the data with one parameter. So we're just going down the list, and as you come down, we're allowing it to maximize the Fisher's exact score test to get the maximum enrichment it possibly can for any cutoff using mutual information or correlation between the transcription factor and the target gene. And so when we do that, in fact, we can never get a better cutoff, a better p-value than 10 to the minus 6 for direct relationships or 10 to the minus 19th for indirect for mutual information. If we separate out direct and indirect reactions, so what I showed you before had them lumped together, Gemini actually does even better for the highest confidence reactions. For direct known mechanistic relationships, the p-value for its enrichment is 10 to the minus 172. And for indirect relationships, it still holds up 10 to the minus 104. And so in any case that we look at this, we find much better enrichment for mechanistic associations by filtering through biochemistry, by filtering it through a metabolic network, than we do just trying to amplify correlated gene expression data. And again, I think that's important because there are hundreds of papers trying to amplify this gene expression relationships. Very little work. This is the only paper I know about that does this, that uses a metabolic network instead to try to understand what might be mechanistic and what might not be. So we can use this then in the context of a iterative approach for model building. So here, so we took our initial yeast tract network, we ran it through Gemini. You end up with a refined network that is in, where you include only those transcription factor relationships that gave us a correct prediction when we integrated with metabolism. You can iterate on that then. And essentially what we did is we learned this on glucose and then just saw, did the refined networks do better on different carbon sources? And the answer to that ended up being yes. So in galactose, we initially got a 0.2 correlation in terms of predicting growth rate for the transcription factor knockouts, p-value of 0.04. After this process, we got a correlation of 0.47, p-value 10 to the minus 7th. And for urea, we went from 0.22, p-value 0.05, to correlation of 0.59, p-value 10 to the minus 12th. So again, so when we did the optimization on glucose, it also did a lot better just taking that model under new conditions as well, galactose and urea. Okay, and again, this was all published in PLOS Computational Biology. Okay, so take home points three. So introduced to you this new approach that we call Gemini, which is our very first attempt to curate the inference of a regulatory network using a metabolic network. That's not a proper inference method yet or anything like that, but it shows very tantalizing signal that is larger as far as from every measure we've done compared to the amount of information that's in correlated movement of expression data. Integrating with metabolic phenotypes, we found was much better than mutual information or correlation in differentiating gold standard verified interactions in yeast. I think this suggests that this is an avenue that's well worth studying. It does require quite a lot of information and data, right? You've got to have a metabolic network, you've got to have transcription factor knockouts and so forth, but it shows that there's a lot of signal in understanding the underlying biochemistry for figuring out which configurations of a gene regulatory make sense and those that don't. And it lets you use a huge amount of information like knockout lethalities, like growth rates, et cetera, in the process of gene regulatory network inference that are totally impossible to use if you don't have that. Okay. All right, next little vignette. We've got about 20 minutes. Yeah.
Why is this enrichment that uses this metabolic network giving you a better refinement than other methods?
Yeah. So
is it because you're using qualitatively different kind of information that you were not using in other methods?
Yes, I believe that that's true. So qualitatively, you can use more information, right? Because when you integrate it with the metabolic network, you can now use not just information that's proximal in the gene expression, but you can also use distal or kinds of information like the growth rate change, like the lethality of a knockout and things like that. So I think that's helpful. A second is that for whatever reason, when you link it through the biochemistry, you really are giving it a lot of information about how all these things are interrelated in the cell. And it's hard to explain exactly, but we just find that when we did that, I was pretty shocked when this came out. I didn't believe it for quite a long time when we were going through this with Shriram. I was pretty amazed at how well this came up and how well it stood up to us banging on it for a few months. Another aspect is that the gene expression data itself is just, it's notoriously messy. I mean, you and I were talking about it right before jumping in to this talk. And so you know, even though we do a lot with mutual information and correlation, there's so much more happening inside the cell that is not included in that, in those comparisons. And I think that the integration via the metabolic network to predict something like a growth phenotype is just so much more, it involves so much more of the cell, and it involves so many more interconnected parts that when you get that right, that it's just much more likely that you've hit something that's really mechanistic in a sense. And so that's what we see. And so there's a, you know, I feel like we've just taken a couple steps down a long, challenging path, but I do think that there's a lot of potential for following up this kind of work and trying to, you know, and trying really to understand it in some more depth. Yeah. Basically, yeah. I mean, it's based not just the correlation. It's based on if you perturb the transcription factor, what change. That's why when we looked at indirect reactions, I figured, like when we first started this, I figured that the mutual information correlation would do better, because I figured that's based on gene expression change, and the indirect is in fact based on gene expression change, just, you know, where you induce the perturbation. But even in those cases, Gemini did way better, you know, going through the metabolic network did way better than mutual information or correlation, even when we allowed those methods to overfit, which we didn't allow Gemini to do. Oh, how much correlation between the hits? Well, it's not the same, because there's a lot more that are found. You know, I don't remember exactly what the correlation was between those. And it's a great question. I should know that right off. But I'll look into that, because it's a great question. Because it wasn't like the mutual information correlation was just a subset of the metabolism. Like, they were certainly divergent. They pulled out different aspects that turned out to be true. But we got just a lot more enrichment from the metabolic one. But even with the enrichment for metabolism, I mean, there's a long way to go. It's not like our accuracy is super high, right? It's not like when we did those predictions that we just pulled out, you know, nothing but the good ones and left out all the bad ones, right? But the enrichment was very substantial. Yeah.
You've added only transcription factor and target metabolic genes. What about other regulatory interactions, like maybe phosphorylation?
Yeah, that we can't actually do anything for in this within Gemini. So explicitly on both sides, we only considered the genes that involve transcription factors and metabolic targets. Because we're filtering through a metabolic network, ultimately everything we do has to tie back to some enzyme. Otherwise, we can't make any prediction on it. So Gemini is not like a replacement, certainly, for, you know, what you would do with gene regulatory networks, because it only applies to a subset of regulatory interactions. And we only claim, of course, that Gemini is better than the transcription factor gene predictions that we see for target genes that are enzymes, right? There's no means to compare to anything that is not an enzyme, because if it's not an enzyme at the target, then it doesn't connect in via PROM, and we don't make any prediction for it at all with this approach. So it only works, and that's about 20% of targets, though. So it's a substantial fraction of the regulatory network, but, you know, it doesn't help you with the whole thing. Okay, so let's, a few minutes left here, just talk a little bit about single cell metabolic analysis. So one is it's known that there are copy number distributions within proteomes here for the E. coli proteome. So this is data taken from Sunny Sheehan's Science. And then we did some analysis of this, you can't see this here, but in a paper in a Physical Review Letters back in 2010 with Panjun Kim, former postdoc of mine. And basically, so you get this distribution in protein copy number, right, or distribution in enzyme copies, And these tend to follow at least somewhat close to a log normal distribution. And so you get wide variety in the amount or the number of proteins in any particular cell. And so what we thought we would, or what we wanted to do here, was to simulate constraining the E. coli metabolic network based on sampling from these distributions that Sunny Shi had measured for different protein concentrations, different enzyme concentrations at the single cell level. Now, there's a lot of challenges in doing this, and there are a lot of limitations to it right now. For one is that this distribution is measured one protein at a time. So you don't have all the correlations. You just have the distribution within any particular cell of an enzyme abundance. Okay. And so in looking at this, in essence, what we wanted to do then is just to incorporate all of this information onto the metabolic network. And we had counts available for about 400 different proteins, okay, from Sunny Shi's data. And so the way this worked then is that we could simulate an isogenic population, or isogenic populations of E. coli, I should say, so where we sample out of all of these different distributions, and then we establish, and then we just modulate the Vmax of the associated reactions based on the concentration of that protein. So here's uptake rates in a growth medium. So Vmax just equals copy number times kcat, of course. And then you create instances of all kinds of different E. coli cells out of these distributions. We then perform flux balance analysis, and then we look at the growth rates and establish flux distributions. And this was work done in PNAS by Piyushal Labsawar, which I'm probably pronouncing badly here, but Piyush, who was jointly advised by myself and Zan Schulten at Illinois. And so what was interesting out of all this, and I'm just going to go through a very limited amount of this in the interest of time, but basically when we did a simulation, what we were able to see was this sort of characteristic pattern for the population. And this is just a simulation, so we don't know, you know, how true this is. This is looking at, this is growth rate, and then this is the probability density that we got. So you'd have some that would grow really slowly based on our sampling of those distributions, others that would be up near maximal and so forth. And what we saw was kind of two phases here, where you have kind of a imposition of maybe a couple of normal distributions, one very broad here across growth rate, and another with a spike sort of here near maximal. Now, what was interesting, and I don't know exactly what to make of this, so I'm just going to throw it up, see if it's interesting to you, is that right around the time that we published this, and this is for E. coli, we got the first measurements that I know of ever for growth rate distributions in yeast. And it turned out to look like this. And so I thought this was sort of interesting because it has at least some characteristics kind of similar to what we got from a very flawed kind of situation simulation here. And this is what the distribution of specific growth rates in fact looked like, where you again see something like a normal distribution here, or kind of flattened, I suppose, but then another kind of monomodal peak, I guess I should just say, here, kind of near growth. And so what we're interested in is trying to dive into these kind of things in more detail and understand, you know, how much differentiation there is at the single cell level. And we're just starting to do this. And we have, Piyush has been working on another paper, which will be submitted shortly, which has now built this whole kind of simulation now for yeast as well, with kind of a more direct calculation. So I don't know if there's anything special about, you know, this sort of shape, this or not. I guess we'll find out as we go ahead. Okay, last little piece, as I just want to give you a few thoughts on comparative model analysis and evidence. Yeah, yeah.
Independently from different
Oh, yeah, that's, yeah. I guess in condensing this, I lost that part. So we tried it in a few different ways. So we tried independently as one of the ways, which of course is not a great way. And then we also did it based on taking lots of gene expression data and getting the correlation at the transcript level, and then just using those correlations as the amount of correlation that would exist between at the protein level, which is also not a great assumption, but I can't think of anything better to do right now. And so that's why I say this was an interesting exercise, but there were a lot of, and I think it got, was published in PNAS mostly because it was the first time that anyone had integrated these with single cell data, but there's huge limitations to what we actually have, because you're not measuring single cell proteomes, which is what you'd really want. And that's why I found it interesting that there was at least some similarity between this, really kind of shot in the dark, try to estimate correlations as best we could, shape, and then the first ever measurement of single cell growth rates. And so, and there's some serious, there's differences. This slope here is a lot bigger than the slope here and so forth. But I kind of found it interesting that there was at least at a very high level some similarities here. None, because they just measure one protein at a time. So that was our big limitation, and that was our big worry in the study. And of course the paper, all kinds of caveats in there because of it. Same conditions. Yeah. No, it was the first time anyone had ever measured them, so it's the first view of how big the differences are. Yes, Andrea. On the Vmax, yep. Usual FBA, yes.
And with different limits in place for each of those 400 reactions.
That's right. And it turns out that only about 13 of them are by far the most important to driving the growth rate. They're the ones that pop up much more commonly than the others. And they're also kind of on the lower side, of course. So we put in, but we do have simulations for all 400. But there's a smallish number that usually end up being the one that's limiting to you. Well, it depends what you mean by that. So, one interesting thing is that we, in our simulations, it would be pretty hard, and you can see it here actually in the actual data from yeast. You just can't hit up to this maximum growth all the time because you have all the stochastic fluctuation. And I think the stochastics here would make me question, how it makes me think that when we have a maximum growth and we're looking at a population, unless you have done the adaptive evolution, in the lab so that you're just really pushing things to optimize like crazy, that if you have this distribution, right, maybe it's much more likely to say, if I'm measuring a bulk growth rate, I really expect it to be at 80% of whatever my maximum is because I've got all these cells that are growing, at lower growth rate compared to the high ones. The other interesting thing here is that, you might think of this as being a population of cells that's really highly optimized for its current condition, and that these are, a population of cells that are more generalized or sort of in waiting for, variation that's going to come into the environment, and they're sort of ready so that if you have a big environmental insult, maybe it's these that tend to die earlier and these survive, and then you reestablish a new distribution in the new, those are the kind of things that come to my mind, when I look at this.
Okay, so So a few thoughts on comparative model analysis. So the other thing that we did was look at yeast predictions across multiple models, multiple biomass equations, multiple experimental data sets, and so forth. And so,
thank you. Got it. Great. Thanks. Is that better? Okay. So this is just looking at Matthew's correlation coefficients for predictive accuracy across all of the different models under many different conditions. And I won't go through this. This is really better for the paper because it's so much. And then it's color-coded so you can see a little bit better. And so anyway, we did a huge amount of work to look at the performance of the 18 models that have been developed for yeast over the last decade or so. And so if you look at this then, across all the different models, this is on a default biomass, which is the biomass that was used by them, or across a standardized biomass. Basically, this shows the Matthews correlation coefficient change over time for all of the models. And so what you see is that it's fairly standard for a long while. The last two consensus reconstructions, E6 and E7, end up being by far the best here. Here's just the equation for a Matthews correlation coefficient. And so as we look at that, then we get, in essence, similar genomic coverage, but somewhat of a trend towards improved predictive accuracy, although not as monotonic as you might expect. And the interesting thing that we saw here was that there tended to be kind of a leap in that a model either vastly increased the scope of what was involved in yeast, or else it improved its accuracy. And we almost never saw those two things together, which was sort of interesting as we went through this. Okay, so it's 4 o'clock, so final take-home points. So the single-cell approaches, as I showed, are in their earliest stages for metabolism. I think there's going to be a lot to learn, very nascent effort, lots of caveats, but it'll be interesting to see how that goes. I showed just a teeny bit about the yeast metabolic network comparisons that we've made. If you want to see that in detail, it's actually, I think, really a nice paper that Ben Hefner and my group wrote that goes through the whole history of those models and fields that just came out in the last month in PLOS Computational Biology. And I'd already mentioned that. With that, let me just thank the people who actually did this work. So the probabilistic or likelihood-based annotation was done by Matthew Benedict, who's now at Dow Chemical, and Nick Chia, who's now professor of microbiome at the Mayo Clinic. The PROM model, the Gemini model that I talked about, was all done by Shriram Chandrasekaran, who's now a Harvard Junior Fellow. The model for methanogens was done by Matthew Benedict, and the the iDream model was done primarily by Joy Wang, who's now a professor at Shanghai Zhongtao University. With that, I guess we're done. Happy to take any final questions, or we'll go to break. Thanks.